Good evening and welcome to the Anglo-Belarusian Society's International Day of Belarusian Culture. Today, 7th of July, 2021, we're celebrating the birthday of Janka Kupala, Jan Szaszo, and Mark Chagall. And here in the United Kingdom, we're meeting several of the contributors to the understanding, performance, and exhibition of Belarusian culture in the UK. I want to start by recognizing many leading contributors to the understanding of Belarusian culture in the UK, who sadly can no longer be with us, in particular Father Alexander Nadsen, Vera Rich, and Guy Picardo, who during this hour of celebrating Belarusian culture in Britain, I'm sure we will be recalling on several occasions. I'm now going to move to the Janka Kupala poem, which international groups and in celebrating this across the world are at their events, recalling the Janka Kupala poem, which Vera Rich translated the title as, "And Say, Who Goes There?" A poem written in 1907. And for the Belarusian, I'm going to turn to Elena Edwards.
Janka Kupala, а хто там іде? А хто там іде? А хто там іде? У огромністей такой громаде.
Белорусы.
А што яны нясуць на худых плячах, на руках у крыві, на нагах у лапцях?
Сваю
крыўду. А куды ж нясуць гэту крыўду ўсю?
На свет.
Крыўду несць навчыў, разбудзіў іх сон.
Бяда, гора.
А чаго ж, чаго захацелась ім, пахарджаным век, ім, сляпым, глухім?
Людьмі звацца.
The English translation, Vera Rich, from her book Like Water, Like Fire, published 1971. And say, who goes there? And say, who goes there? In such a mighty throng assembled, oh, declare. And what do those lean shoulders bear as load, those hands stained dark with blood, those feet bast sandal shod, all their grievance? And to what place do they this grievance bear? And whither do they take it to declare? To the whole world? And who schooled them thus, many million strong? Bear their grievance forth, rouse them with slumbers long, want and suffering. And what is it then for which so long they pined, scorned throughout the years, they, the deaf, the blind, to be called human? I'm now going to turn the present day Belarus community. There is a strong, vibrant, ever-growing community of Belarusians in the UK, exemplified by over 500 gathering to celebrate the Baltic Way in the center of London on 23rd of August, year 2000. Kupala has traditionally been one of the largest gatherings of Belarusians in the UK, the Kupala Night. This year, constraints on gathering meant numbers that could gather were much smaller. But through a very fine video made by Sasha Belovukova, we're going to see a little excerpt, 4 minutes of this year's event, Kupala 2021.
Проявилась, сестра с братом пропала. Сестра с братом пропала. А братцы кажутеньки, а сестрица синенька. А сестрица синенька, а братейка жовтенький, бо ён плакав мовченький, бо ён плакав мовченький. А чи сестриця синенька, бо плакала сильненька, бо плакала сильненька. А чи неся нова клець? Сестра з братом з клеці дідь. Сестра з братом з клеці дідь. О, Бог мене застерог, що сестрою спать не лёг. Что сестрою спать не лёг. А Бог мяне миловал, что сестру не обдымал, что сестру не обдымал. Братка с тобою, дай скинемся травою, дай скинемся травою. Ай, на Івана купала, буду девки в краски сти, буду девки в краски сти, будут яны краски рвать, сестру с братом вспоминать. Сестру с братом вспоминать.
Jim, if you want to make some comments about the contemporary translations while Arnold links into them.
Okay, well, I'm going to talk about translation, not so much about my reminiscences and memories of the past, except to say that for me, a regular attender at sessions of the Anglo-Belarusian Society and on friendly terms with many members of the Skurfovania Belarus or Velika Britannia, they provided for me a kind of training ground, a learning ground, eventually for me to go into the translation of some Belarusian books. It would take a whole lecture to say, or to answer the question of whether you can actually translate a culture. But what I would want to do is to limit myself to what I have done and what I hope to be able to do in the future. And that is to, first of all, I have translated 4 books of Belarusian history. I think they would have to be called popular history. The problem here is that these books are not available for purchase in this country. And that then raises a number of issues connected with the translation of any particular book. Since those books of history, I've translated three books that we could call literature, two fiction, two novels, and one a book of essays. Now, these were published by British publishers, which tends to mean that translation could have of literature, for example, could have a real value in informing people about Belarus. Whether they would inform them much about Belarusian culture is an entirely different question. And in publishing translations, and it's worth noting here that translations have become much more common, much more frequent in this country and in North America than they used to be. In translating works of Belarusian literature, we have to consider, firstly, the nature of the publisher. Then once the book is published, we have to consider the extent to which the publication is publicized. There's not much point in publishing a book if it's not publicized and gets no reviews. Nobody will know about it. And then, of course, there is the effect, the result. What lasting result is the translation going to have? I'm hoping that the books that I have translated will eventually stimulate some interest. The most recent one that I have done has now been purchased, or the translation rights have been purchased by a publisher in New York. So the possibility of having it more widespread across the English-speaking world is good. What now depends very much on what I am willing to spend time on translating for no pay to see who will actually publish it. I have some high hopes, and particularly in the wake of Alhard Bacharevich's award of the Erwin Piscator Prize in Germany this year. At least the writer is receiving some kind of international recognition. That's really all I want to say, that I think from my perspective, what I'd like to do is to achieve a greater knowledge of what writers are writing about in Belarus. Whether that is Belarusian culture, I don't know. I leave that for other people to consider. Thank you very much, Alan. Have a good meeting.
Right, we'll now pass back to Arnold. Thank you.
The Anglo-Belarusian Society, founded in 1954, was at first mainly a social organization aimed at acquainting some members of parliament, the aristocracy, and others with the early Belarusian community, and indeed the existence of Belarus. 11 years after its foundation, it took two new and important academic initiatives for disseminating news about and creating interest in Belarus and its culture. From 1965, the Society ran an annual series of six lectures on various aspects of Belarusian culture, ranging from early manuscripts of Cyril of Touro and Saint Euphrosyne of Polotsk, and the secular memoir of Theodor Jaloszewski, both a translation and a study, to the first legal newspaper, Nasza Niwa. Other contributions included studies of religion, contemporary and historical linguistics, the Belarusian Tatars and their writing, early 19th century poetry, the urban geography of Babruisk in the 17th century, and from late in the same century, the influence of Belarusian craftsmen on Muscovite architecture, as well as music, the Podobny chants of the Suprasil Irmalogian, and law, amongst other topics. The speakers were London Belarusians, as well as interested parties, mostly employed, like me, to teach aspects of Russian from various parts of London University and other places, most notably Reading. The Journal of Belarusian Studies profited greatly from the lecture course and included all the topics I've just mentioned, as well as many more. And whilst the speakers were all based in London or within easy reach, the journal also benefited from distinguished overseas scholars, such as Jan Zaprudnik and Paul Wexler, to name but two. At first, the journal was dismissed in Soviet Belarus as amateurish, although the most intelligent Belarusians, like Adam Malzis, valued its broad spectrum of subjects and, of course, its independent viewpoint. Initial scorn, doubtless influenced by the political atmosphere in the Soviet Union, soon turned to keen interest, matching that of scholars in Germany, Israel, North America, and even further afield, who were glad to contribute. To summarize, the lecture course and the early stages of the Journal of Belarusian Studies were mutually beneficial and a credit to the first decade of the Anglo-Belarusian Society. Mm-hmm. And the picture, it shows the ancient Professor Debray giving one of the talks. And next to him, on his right, is Guy Picarda. And facing the camera, but not taking much interest, is Arnold Macmillan. And next to him, Jim Dingley on that side. All in better days. And these are some of the boys from Father Nelson's school also. Thank you. Finished. Finito.
Thank you, and quite a remarkable photo. I'm now going to jump very quickly because the architect of the Belarusian church in Finchley is with us and going to say some words now. ZY So.
Thank you. A few years back, the Belarusian diaspora community in London built this very special church. And I understand that Father Sergei Stasevich is not able to attend the meeting today. So I'm just presenting the church on his behalf. I think, as we all know, the Belarusian community, as we know today, emerged just after the Second World War, and many of them relocated to the UK. And we all know that it was a really horrendous piece of history, really. I mean, one third of the population perished as a result of the Second World War. And they rebuilt their lives here in the UK, in London. And in the late 40s, they've started congregating in this famous building, Marian House in Barnet, which still stands today. And they've converted one of the rooms in the building and turn it into a makeshift place of worship. And I think they all wish to build a proper church one day. And I think around 10 years ago, Father Sergei came to the UK and he reinitiated this project, and he has been the driving force behind the project, really. And also the beloved late Father Nassen was pretty much behind it and very supportive of the initiative. And that took us to Belarus, and we've conducted a very detailed ethnographic research in Belarus, and we can go on for hours talking about the architectural heritage of this amazing country, not just the early examples, but even up to the early 20th century, the country is still producing many influential ideas, both in art and architecture, but I will leave it for another time. But basically, we're not looking to, this is a site just behind the famous Marian House. And basically we're not looking to duplicate the building and rebuild a pastiche of some kind. We're looking to reinterpret, to design a new building, a landmark building, if you like, that embodies the community's collective memories. It's really hard to tell the full story in three minutes. But anyway, there we go. We have a contemporary building inspired by Belarusian, traditional wooden church architecture. And this building could not have happened if we haven't done the research and looked into the Belarusian church tradition. And yeah, since its opening, it's become a much loved building, thanks to Father Sergei, his perseverance, and also the community, and every single member of the community who was behind the project. I think I'm running out of time, right?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Just if we close, but very important to get that reference. And the first wooden church in London since, was it nearly over 300 years?
Well, they said so in the newspaper, in 350
I'm
years.
I'm going to very quickly move to the chair of the Association of Belarusians. Mikolai, just for a very brief 2 or 3 minutes, and also you might want to reference some very important guests from Association of Belarusians we have here. Thank you, Mikolai.
Thank you, Alan. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, good.
Now, what I was going to say, it kind of links up to what Arnold has been saying about the Anglo-Belarusian Society. When the but from the diaspora's viewpoint, that is to say, when the Belarusian post-Second World War diaspora settled in the UK in the late 1940s, the association's primary interest was actually focused on organizing cultural and the public life within the Belarusian expatriate community. It should be highlighted that despite certain items of information, sometimes somewhat mysterious, from the interwar period, in fact, in 1946, Belarusians found no pre-existing Belarusian cultural public life in the UK, unlike, for example, the Ukrainians or Poles. So the ABGB's own contribution into the promotion of Belarusian culture and knowledge about Belarus took three main forms, as I was describing. Firstly, there was cultural engagement with the British community at large by way of Belarusian institutions in London, LL, and elsewhere. For example, when the Belarusian club was opened in Bradford, the ceremony was attended by the mayor and various local English important figures, and some from London. The Bradford Belarusian club became, for certain reasons, popular among the local Brits too, which was helping indirectly to make them familiar with the Belarusian community and their culture. Secondly, the association's members were taking part in non-Belarus-specific demonstrations and events, such as various anti-communist demonstrations, representing Belarus there and promoting knowledge about Belarus. This relates not only to the association, but also to the supporters of the Central Belarusian Council, a competitor organization, the Association of Belarusian Christian Workers in the UK that existed at the time. There was, for example, a Belarusian activist called Bunchuk, who belonged to those organizations and was active in the north of England, engaging with the local Brits in various events and promoting knowledge about Belarus. Also outside the Anglo-Belarusian Society and linked with the Organization of Belarusians of with the Association of Belarusians in Great Britain, but not representing the association. Bishop Sipovich and Father Baburka were taking part in British interfaith religious events representing the Belarusian community. But most importantly, thirdly, the association over the 1950s and all the way to the 1980s saw its main role as supporting the Anglo-Belarusian Society's mission to promote various themes of culture and knowledge about Belarus for English-speaking audiences in the UK. At an earlier stage, the association supported the English lectures on Belarus organized by the ABS. At a later stage, the association decided, for example, to convert its meeting hall at Penrose and office into a new flat in order to rent it out and to use the income to support the Journal of Belarusian Studies. In more recent times, we also supported financially a few instances of visits by Belarusian cultural figures and academic figures, that is from Belarus to the UK. And we made our premises available for short-term accommodation and for meetings. In some cases, those were visits for events specifically within the expatriate and diaspora Belarusian community in the UK. But in other instances, we were supporting activities that helped to project Belarusian culture for English-speaking audiences.
Mikolai, we will have some. Could you just briefly mention some of your former leading members who are here today?
Yes, let me conclude this.
So well, very briefly, quickly,
this
please.
Scheme of cooperation and partnership with the Anglo-Belarusian Society and the Francis Scarino Library as what we should keep and develop in the future. I hope that our former chair, Mrs. Lola Mikhailuk, would have joined this meeting today. I don't know if she has, but I did invite her. She was my predecessor as the chair of the Association of Belarusian and Great Britain, and some of the things I've mentioned, I've learned from her because she was here in the UK. And we
could you please pass now to Carolina for some comments on the library? Is Carolina there? Carolina, unmute. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I understand that we are pressed for time, so I was wondering whether I could show a short video about the library just to introduce
some people. 3 minutes, yes. Your screen share is possible, please.
Thank you. I'll just turn it on. I'll conclude to say that you can see there is this very rich, very unique collection of materials. The library is celebrating this year its 50th anniversary, and it has been a real place of memory for many generations of Belarusians. And now that the Belarusian people are writing a new page of their memory, the library has a role to play as well. And we have new people coming. We have a new generation of Belarusians who are rediscovering their national identity. They're coming to the library. It's interesting that in particular, they want to see the statute of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, our testimony to national statehood. So the library has all of that to offer. It is also a real living hub of people, of events, of conferences, of meetings. So there is a very, very large contribution to the cultural life in the UK that comes from the Skorina Library. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to pass to Vera Horton, who is going to reference also some of the her activities. And very briefly, Vera, if you could maybe only take part of your poem you were proposing, because I think Vera wishes to pay homage to somebody who contributed much, another Vera.
Yes, hello. I've got this wonderful book of Vera Rich in my hands, and I'm in the car, so it will be a little bit rough. However, I think Vera Rich is opening Belarusian poetry not only for English people, but for Belarusian people as well, people like me. And this is the poetry of Yanka Kupala, and in Belarusian it's called «Для земли прадедов моих». But I will read it only in English, and it is for the land of my forebears. O land of those ancient forebears of mine, there is naught in the world I'd not hasten to bring thee. To the whole world I'm ready to sign thee, to raise thee up a throne of those graveyards of thine. Happily with my soul, I will breathe warmth within thee, or wave thee a crown from sun and stars' gold shine, and crown thee with it, though for one moment's time, for thee to shine in beauty all too hard for winning. For thee in the fray I'd perish readily, against the wrong heaped on thee by man and God unkindly, by the stranger and by thine own son in his blindness. I will suffer endless grief and woes eternally. And for this, I'll seek but one small thing from thee, that thou'lt not drive me out, but keep me there abiding. That was translation of Vera Rich. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We're now going to pass on to some of those who were active in bringing Belarusians, and then we're going to hear from some of these Belarusians, active in bringing Belarusians to the UK, starting with hearing from Alison Cameron, who can take us back to the period around about 1990, Alison, when Aberdeen started a link with GoMel.
Thank you very much, Alan. Privitania, Zim. Aberdeen in the northeast of Scotland, that's my hometown, and Gomel, the second largest city in Belarus, were formally twinned in 1990. So I had just arrived at that time, fresh from university, clutching my Russian degree. I arrived in my boss's office and he said, right, forgive the Scots accent here, well, it's good that you're here, because we're going to twin with a Russian city. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. I thought, well, it must be, it's an oil city like Aberdeen. It'll be Tumien or somewhere, semi-sensible. But he then said, it's called Gomel. And I knew enough about Soviet geography at that time to think, oh. So I said, there are two things here I'd like to say. Now, this is my first day in my new job. One is, it's not in Russia. And secondly, have you looked on a map? Ali said, should we have? And I thought, oh, right. It's the center of one of the areas most affected by fallout from Chernobyl 4 years prior. So basically, over a lot of whiskey and vodka at a conference in France, eternal friendship between Aberdeen and Romil was declared, and there was no backing out of it now. Now, I am very glad indeed that we did not back out. Rather than the usual highly ceremonial twinning links, you know, our local politicians weren't that interested in going to somewhere radioactive. So it became about people, and it went on like that. It became a vibrant, creative, and very human connection. It also changed my life. 31 years on, I'm still involved with Belarus. I think it's a terminal condition. I think Alan has it as well, so it's fine. But, you know, thinking about it, were we so different after all? Common factors, connection to the land, farming, hardworking, a bit dour until you get to know us. Our own languages being denigrated. Scots is seen as an inferior form of English, Belarusian, well, it's Trasyanka, it's what the farmers speak. There's tartan, there's bagpipes, the love of a good party, and then a drama too. So my heart was in this work from the start, and it still is. It soon became not a job. To start with, it was about Chernobyl, but that is an unequal relationship of us helping. And I thought it needs to be more than this. There's so much that Belarus can give to us. And I was right. So concentrated on the culture. Thankfully, I managed to meet some key people along the way. I met Father Alexander Madsen. I met Vera Rich. Both of whom took me to the library to get me convinced that there was a distinct entity that was Belarus with a culture of its own. We had artists came over, we exhibited their work in Aberdeen Art Gallery, we commissioned a play which was in three languages, and Vera Rich came up and rehearsed with those. Very good playwright. The play was called The Angels of Paris. We had ballet, and it became quite a kind of chaotic relationship. I would get calls such as from one Rich DeMarco one day saying, just get yourself to St. Andrews. So I just did it. And there was Richard DeMarco, who introduced me to some of the theater companies that we had come over, for example, Zeya. It was a highly successful relationship, really. And, you know, I understood the language. So I'm not sure how active it is now, but really I'm very, very proud of it. And I know a lot of those connections continue. There have been some marriages and so on.
Alison,
I am. Thank you. Shutting up now.
You've just given a lovely link to Richard, who's sitting there.
I know. I'm going to conclude by saying, this is a very neat segue into Richard. Zeya, where am I? I'm in London. I am Scottish on the outside, but my heart is Belarusian. Živje Belarus. And Živje Richard DeMarco.
And thank you. We're now going to pass to Richard, whose birthday we're going to be celebrating in 2 days' time. 91 years young on the 9th of July, and who has done so much. And we're going to hear about that marvelous expedition to Vitebsk, which I'm now going to bring up on the images. I was going to show something of the church, but I hope everybody can see a photograph taken in April 1995. Richard.
My goodness me, that brings back one of the great memories of my long life and the extraordinary relationship, friendship I had with that great man, Alexander Lutsko. And of course, I met him through you. And the fact I was professor of European cultural studies at the university where you were working, Alan, as an expert in, well, nuclear physics. Anyway, that road is important because it led me to many things, to many friendships. And I must say, I never forget Alexander Lutsko as one of the great, great, great Europeans. He and I live in Europe. We don't live anywhere else. And we ignore all boundaries, all national boundaries. And I'm thinking of the importance of these two artists here who are in the world of Malevich, Chagall, etc., which I believe the world should not forget. This is a Belarusian avant-garde world that is associated with the cities of Minsk and Vitebsk, and it should be taken very seriously by the British art world. Unfortunately, this is not the case. So I must renew somehow my contacts with Belarus, with your help, Alan, because naturally I feel very unhappy with the situation in Belarus today and with the whole concept of Brexit. Brexit should never have happened because obviously Scotland is a European country. It's not an American country. It's not a country, disconnected from the Baltic, from the world of Belarus. It is intimately connected. And I feel that we've hardly begun our work together, Alan. I don't know if we could reconnect with the University of Kingston to remind them that in this day and age, they have a special responsibility because Kingston at one time welcomed the world of Alexander Lutsko.
Now, Richard, you asked about connecting. We have online here Galina, who is in that photograph. Photographia. Galina, Gavari Paruski, pa Belarus. We have Vitebs online, Richard.
Well, she is a wonderful artist. And I think the time has come when I must, if possible, put on an exhibition of her work. We can do it online.
Galina is in the image at the back of that photograph. And Richard, you invited these artists, you invited many theatre people. And what is this image we see here of you in Edinburgh?
Well, there's no doubt. I mean, that's a Welsh, Celtic, Gaelic artist called Tim Jones.
And the work behind, Richard, I think this is the work you discovered in Vitebsk.
That's right.
And an example of bringing Belarusian culture. Now, we're going to move to two artists. They're called Studio Cipollino. Studio Cipollino, unmute, please. Privet. Tanya Popova, Gennady Gatovichits. Tanya Popova Gatovichits now. And Gena. Richard, you invited the great theatre Jaya and Mikolai Trukan three times, 95, 96, 97.
Well, can I say?
listening to Tanya, your chance to say some words to Richard.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I.
Richard, just wait one second. One second.
I'm so Tanya. Pleased to see you.
Good evening, dear friends. We are so glad to see today Richard DeMarco, who do so much for our theater, not only for our theater, Jaya, And I know for the other Belarusian theaters. And I'm so glad to see you, Oleg Garbus, with who we go to Edinburgh Festival. And now you wanted to say some words about the theater day and how we were in Edinburgh Festival and to show some photos. Alan, if it's possible to show our photographs.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
Это Геннадій Гатовчиць розказує про театр «Дія», який створив Микола Трухан зі своїм сябром Віталієм Барковським. Одночі на репетиціях двері чинилися, і у репетиційну залу вийшов, ми це побачили, телефон. Потім почули beautiful, а не телефон, а фотоапарат. Після фотоапарата ми почули beautiful, fantastic, brilliant. Так ми познайомилися з Річардом Демарко, який нас запросив на Эдинбургский фестиваль. Окрім нас, він запросив ще й вольну сцену і альтернативний театр. Ми поїхали у Англію, і там зустріли, нас зустріли. Це ж Эдинбург, а до цього нас зустрів Олександр Надсон, познайомив нас з білоруською діаспорою, познайомив нас з бібліотекою чудовною. Ми грали у його за домом на лужайці свої спектаклі для наших білорусів, які живуть у Лондоні. Ось. Після ми познайомилися ще з одним сябром, який нам допомагав. Це Алан Флаус, ви всі його ведаєте. Гэтий чалавек нам памог 3 гады падрад весці Эдинбург спектаклі. І ми паспелі звесці і здань паказаць в Эдинбурзе «Чорты бабу», «Жанізьбу», «Круці», «Распад» і нават «Барановы кароль». Вот. І што нас уразіло больш цього, нам было так вельмі хвалюючы, пачуць крытыку эдинбургских, ангельских вот, критиков. Вот. И что? Отрымалось, что белорусские спектакли могут отрымовывать высшие 5 зорок, а спектакль «Здань» навод вошел в тыдень, лепший спектакль тыдня. Вот. А еще хочу сказать,
Еще мы хотели рассказать про то, что нам было вельми цікаво и приемно працавать на ангельского глядача, и тому, что мы не ведали, який будет отклик. Але сапраўды это было настолько чудово, что нас разумели, нават что наши спектакли были на ангельской мове. Только там сам на сам недзе мы уживали ангельскую мову. А так усе спектаклі шлі на беларускай мове. Але тым не менш, спектакль «Жанітьба» па Гогалю нават прадавалася так добра, што ён у Лондоне, каб усе жадаючы змаглі папаць на гэты спектакль. А зараз вы бачыце фотаздымак нашай рэпетыцыі спектакля, дзе занятыя акцёры, якія сышлі з тэатру за палітычную сітуацыю ў нашай краіне, якія прысоединіліся да забастоўцы, і мы самі вырашылі
узнавіць спектакль Трухана і мужа. У нас, мне здаецца, атрымалася, і мы марым проста, каб гэты спектакль і іншы спектакль беларусаў пабачылі. Таму вам роўна на хвілінку пакажам маленькі кавалачкі з гэтага спектакля, пра што мы і пра што ставіў Трухан. Адна хвіліна.
Beautiful.
Жизнь нас от полою всякой. все живое. Страх перед концом отшиваю. И убачил я новое небо и новую землю. Моцны слабого б'є. Чоловічі закони потоптали, а до боских нема моці дорасти. Треба чоловічі закони ладить. А як?
Дякую, дякую великий. And again, thanks so much that you hear us, and we hope, Richard DeMarco, that we meet you in Edinburgh again. Thank you very much.
Well, you're always welcome in my world, and I think the time has come when we will do something together by a virtual version of your theater. I think we could include it in this year's Edinburgh Festival. So I will depend on you and Alan to help me put together a manifestation of your theater in virtual form.
Oh my goodness.
That's what we should do.
And this is memories of 25 years ago. The Preglasheni DeMarco. Oleg Garbuz is waiting for us. We're going to hear Oleg. Oleg, you hear us?
Yeah.
We're going to hear Macbeth.
Yes, Macbeth. My gosh.
Privet. Okay, yeah. Oleg.
Hello, my dear friends. Do you hear me? Hello.
Yes.
Okay. I'm... Hello, everybody and everything. Як у нас кажуть, оптиму в розницю. Привітання, коханенькі, родненькі. What can I say? It was so long time ago. I was younger. It was, Macbeth was in 96. And what can I do, Alan? Can I read something from Macbeth? What do you think?
Yes, I think you should.
You were going to read some lines, 2 minutes of Macbeth, and then we're going to pass to Zmitser after Oleg.
And for Richard DeMarco, I'm glad to see you. Absolutely crazy man, absolutely. And Alan was in the beginning the crazy way. But you still alive and you still crazy. It's fantastic, beautiful, brilliant. Yeah. And now Macbeth for you. And before Duncan's mother, when Macbeth sees before his eyes a dagger.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, a dagger.
Dagger, yeah. In Belarusian. Откуль ты? Откуль? Кинжал, узникший у поветры передо мной. Ты повернулся ручкой до мяне, каб лепей было схапить. Хапаю, и нема. Рука пустая. Але ж вачыма не перастаю я бачыць тебе, хотя рукой не адчу. А может, ты
народжений збянтеженою душою? Диня, тебе все бачу пред собою. Ты поводыр мой на моем шляху. Куды исти, чим мне заулодать? Ты хочешь предказать мне лёс? Альбо наадворот? Мене ты хочешь подмануть? Тебе все бачу. Лязо покрылось кроплями крыви. Не. Глупство все. Тебе не існує. Кривавый план прымае бачны вобраз. Трывалая земля. Дзе б не ішоў я. Не прислухоўвайся до тихих крокаў. А то камень не стануць размаўляць і выдадуць мяне. Кароль жывы, а я тут разважаю. Хопіць. Бувал развах, жар дзеяння затопіць. Белс? Час. Час. На звон з табой пакліку. Донкан. Не слухай, то хаутурны звон. Цябе ці ў рай, ці ў пекла кліча ён. And next, the murder of Duncan. Yeah, thank you. It was beautiful.
Thank you for bringing back the memory when Belarusian was spoken from a Scottish castle, thanks to the production of Richard DeMarco and all your friends, many colleagues. Now we've got about 10 minutes before we must close. And in these last 10 minutes, I was going to briefly just ask James Mallinson's waited from America for some comments on the success again. And then we're going to move to Victor and Todor to play us out. Victor first and then Todor. So just a quick minute, sorry, as you've appreciated, James, some technical issues have delayed us.
Oh, thank you very much, Alan. I'm very much honored to be included in this company. Forgive me for looking a little on the shaggy side. I'm on holiday in Michigan, where we enjoy much of the same life as in the countryside in Belarus, with the lakes and the green and the growing things. But it meant so much to be able to play a part in bringing the Teatr Emilia Kupakolasa from Vitebsk to the United States. It was very much a growth from the work that had been established in Edinburgh by Richard DeMarco, by Alan, with also the support over the time for Terry Newman, who had done so much over the years, Shayla Batchelder, who had founded Rocket Venues and had worked with Richard and Alan for many years. So many challenges. I definitely sympathize with Mr. Dingley. I heard his comment earlier about not getting paid, and hearing Allison's comment about that it's a lifelong commitment once one becomes dedicated to Belarusian culture. And I'm happy to sit now on the board of a foundation here in the United States called the Belarus Kuchowski Foundation that does continue support for. Hey, Victor. There's another one.
Before, sorry for that. Better mute Victor. Before Victor comes in, he seems to have.
That's all right. I love you, Victor. Two He's references. An old friend of mine. It's all good. We've rapped together.
James, two references. Year 2000, Richard, Chagall, Chagall. We honor the Theatre Jakob Kulas from Vitebsk, who won the prize of the Edinburgh Festival, the Fringe First Prize in the year 2000. It took another 11 years. The Belarus Free Theatre, with the production, Victor Sherban was the artistic director, and he won the Edinburgh Fringe First. Belarusian culture can make a big impact. We've now got a young musician sitting in Moscow, who I first met in Vitebsk in about the year 2001. And he goes under the name Vic Villian, and he was a musician. I see somebody with a guitar. I'm gonna leave these two musicians for the next 8 minutes, 10 minutes to play us out. before the football. So over to Vic Villain in Moscow, and there's another musician sitting in Minsk. It's Viktor Rudenko. Please speak. And Victor's going to pass to our last musician.
Since this is like it's more or less. I'm sitting here in my studio in Musical Wave Studio in Moscow. Yeah, and well, it's made a long way around the globe just to come here. Even though Moscow is pretty close to Belarus, I just actually was a huge journey. And that did involve lots of...
I just want to say I love you, bro.
Pardon? Can you hear me? Oh, yeah.
I just want to say I love you, bro. I miss you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's we should meet sometime. I mean, sometimes we talk, but it's not so often, unfortunately. Okay.
Well, they got a meeting to put on, but you have a good show, all right? See you later.
Well, yeah. Okay, yeah, see you later. Yeah, so, well, getting back to what it was when we first came to the UK, I think it was, Dr. Farris, you must remember the exact date, but it was maybe like 11 years ago, something like that. And first it was connected to European Youth Parliament that I was taking part in. But then I cannot hear you, unfortunately. You muted the microphone.
We'll have to move to the music now.
Oh yeah, let's do the music, yeah. Shall we do the reversal stuff or shall we do something?
Belarusian.
Yeah, we do have Belarusian stuff, but what I'm saying is that, okay, let's do the revolution song. Even though I showed it to Richard DeMarco, by the way, it was at Edinburgh Fringe Festival, and he said, well, I love the muscles of this young revolutionary man. That's what he said. And then, okay, yeah. And then I met my...
12, yeah.
Yeah, and then I met Milland, who was actually working with the Massive Attack, and he offered me to do a video, but we never did it, unfortunately. Okay, let's do the song. It is called Wake Up, but it's never been released, and it's going to be released like in a couple of days now. I mean, it was written 11 years ago. Can you hear the guitar?
Yeah.
Больш не треба слов, больш не треба снов. Час розвітатися, час розквітатися, час, час, час. Як махи нахиляли нас до землі, а тепер погляди, ми гахаємо полем'я нас. I'm not sure that the sound was good. I didn't manage to plug everything in because we had a like a very rough day today. So yeah, I think that you only heard the voice which was screaming out from the which was like Victor screaming, and that's it. Okay. I guess that was the sound, right?
Okay. Yeah, we got it. Can you do your link now?
Yes, and I think that we should take a listen to a person that some of you might know. That comes from, is that the one? Is that what you want, Dr. Flores? Yeah. We should take have a listen to a guy that we that probably some of us know, like 99% of Belarusians, something like that. Yeah. Zmitser Vatyushkevich is coming right now, right? Is that the link, right? Okay.
Okay.
Hello, everyone. I wish you victory for England. in football and song, песня на верш Владимира Короткевича. Где мой край? Лай, лай, ла, 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 лай, ла, 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 ла. Где мой край? Там, где вечную песню пея Беловежа, там, где Неман нас захоти помнить ворожую кровь. Где на взвышших новоградских дремлют суровые вежи, и вишневые хаты глядятся в широкий Днепро. Ты ляжешь там, где синяя Припять ласкаво веется, где София плыве над Двиною небы корабей, там, где сердце мое с першим кроком, як молот забьется, коли б навод сляпым и глухим я пришел до тебе, что сляпым на вот мертвым вспомню высокие озоры, над ракою червоной и тьмяной полет кожаной, белый ветрость на гордых, на синих, як мора озер, и бары океаны, и небо разливы, и льно. Где мой край? Там, где люди николи не будут рабами, что за полю носит ярмо в безнадейной турме, где осилки хлопцы молодыми взрастают дубами, а мужчины, як скалы, ударыш и зломится меч. Там звенять неумерушие песни на полные груди, там с продвеку гучить моя мова булатный клинок, я гордая мова, якую и тады не забудь, коли солнце землею в опошне заглыбится змрок. Лай, лай, ла, ла, лай, лай, ла, ла, лай, ла, ла, лай, 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 ла, ла, лай, лай, ла, ла, лай, ла, ла, лай. Ты наш край, ты червоная груша над дедовским домом листопадовским, с ничек густых фосфорычной рать. Ты наш стяг, что никому на свете, никому, не дому обсмеять и поганить, забыть, и мячом завоевать. Мы клянемся тебе.
Добрый.
На поле и опошней ролей, на якую упадем в журбе. Мы клянемся тебе, что николи, так николи не кинем тебе. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Дякую, великий. And a big thank you to all those who've joined us. Valery Martinchik struggled 1 hour. Just a quick word of hello from Valery. We're going to have to hear from you the next time, though. Who remembers Richard? A greeting from Valery Martinchik, who was brought with the artist Mick Galina. Just one word at the end. Valery, do you hear us, Susha? Yeah, very quickly. The football starts in 3 minutes. 1 minute.
Okay. Next time.
Just greet Richard from wherever you are, London. Greeting. And okay, greet Galina. Maybe speak some. Where is Galina from? Sitting in Vitebsk. She can hear us. Galina, your artist friend, is in Vitebsk and can hear you, but something wrong with her sound. So to everybody else, Thank you to all who joined us. A very full program and all your fantastic preparation, bringing back the beautiful memories of Belarusian culture in the United Kingdom. This is not the end of a program. It's the start. New beginnings, as Richard DeMarco has so often said, and we heard the invitation. We can get everybody in contact through this wonderful medium. So wonderful. So many names here. Thank you to everybody who joined in this evening. And let's work for the new good future of Belarusian culture throughout the world, not only
well
UK.
Done. Well done, Alan.
Well
Dziękuję
done.
Dziękuję veliki. So.
Dziękuję. Belarus.
Bravo. Yeah. Bravo. Yeah. Bravo.
Bravo. Bravo. Yeah, Richard DeMarco.
Живе.
Живе. Yeah.